Welcome back from the break. It's my pleasure to announce the speakers of the next short course. It's co-taught by Florence Demenet and Emmanuel Rousigon. Emmanuel will go first, but I'll introduce them in reverse order. So Florence Demenet is a founding member of the network that underlies the series of summer schools. She is a global authority in genetic epidemiology, which is, for example, demonstrated by the fact that she was the president of the International Genetic Epidemiology Society in 2008. She won several big prizes in the field, the INSERM Prix de Recherche Clinique in 2003, and an award by the French Academy of Sciences in Epidemiology in 2010. She is the director of research for genetic variation and human diseases at INSERM now for 40 years. We are very happy to have her in our network, to be one column of our network that supports our efforts for years. And we are also happy that she will present here today, together with Emmanuel Rousigon, who is also at INSERM and also a leading expert in statistical genetics and genetic epidemiology. She's a member of the board of directors of the French Federation of Human Genetics and a board member of the French Society of Human Genetics as a treasurer. They are both world-renowned experts for genome-wide association studies, and that's what they are going to talk about today. We are very happy to have you here. The word and the floor is yours, Emmanuel.
Thank you, Kerstin. So, I begin. So Florence and I will present GWAS and post-GWAS strategies to uncover the genetic mechanism underlying multifactorial disease. The talk is organized in two parts. I will present the GWAS part and Florence will present the post-GWAS part. In my presentation, I will give the principle of GWAS, imputation and meta-analysis, some different tools that contribute to the identification of tree-associated genetic variant. Then I will show you how the integration of functional annotation of disease loci by using EQTL or epigenetic data can help identifying genes involved in disease susceptibility. So what is a GWAS? The goal of GWAS is to detect association between between genetic polymorphism and a trait, which may be qualitative as a disease status such as asthma, diabetes, or obesity, quantitative such as blood glucose level, BMI, or we can also study time to disease onset. GWAS relies on specific genetic variant called SNPs for single nucleotide polymorphisms. SNPs are DNA sequence variations occurring when a single nucleotide at a given position in the genome is altered. In the GWAS, we in fact perform association analysis with a panel of SNPs that are adequately spaced along the genome to capture most of the linkage disequilibrium between SNP. I mean, linkage disequilibrium between SNP is in fact correlation between SNP. So what we measure? In fact, we observe genotype data, we observe a disease phenotype, and we test association between this phenotype and the markers. But the idea is if the SNPs are adequately spaced on the genome, they can capture unobserved markers, so ungenotyped markers that are in reality the disease susceptibility locus. It is due to linkage equilibrium, the decorrelation between the SNPs. So GWAS were made enabled by advancing high throughput genotyping technology. With microarray, now we are able to have access to more than 500,000 to 1 million SNPs genotyped in a single individual. So when you receive GWAS data, you receive a file, not clean. So the first step you have to do is to conduct, to perform a quality control on both and the individuals that are included in your genotype file and on markers. First, you check samples. You will compute the what we call the call rate of individuals, so the proportion of success. So if the subject with a success sample less than 95 or 97% are excluded, you will check and the heterozygosity. You will compute global heterozygosity and specific heterozygosity for chromosome Y and chromosome X. You will search for critical and unsuspected relatedness between among individuals of your study sample. And if you have family data, if you analyze family data, you will search for Mendelian errors too. Finally, using genotype data, you will compute, you will perform a principal component analysis to correct for population structure. This PCA will be done by using a set of uncorrelated SNPs, around 80,000 SNPs that are genotyped in your data and are also available in reference panels such as AppMap data. And this principal component analysis will allow you detecting outliers and correct for cryptic structure. And this and the principal components extracted from this PCA analysis can be used to adjust for stratification in the following statistical test that you are performing GWAS analysis. Indeed, population stratification is the main issue in GWAS. Population structures is important to take into account in GWAS, even within population of European ancestry. As shown in this slide, there is a close correspondence between principal components of genetic variation in Europe and geographical map. Once you have done the quality control on subject, you can do a quality control on markers. Again, you will compute the proportion of success of markers, the call rate of SNPs, and you will exclude missing SNPs if the missingness was upper than 3 or 5%. You will compute the R-divine-Bay equilibrium. This is, in fact, R-divine-Bay equilibrium is a relation, a fixed relation between allele and genotype frequencies. And you will check this. Any deviation for Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium in control and exclude SNP if you found test deviation from Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. And then finally, you will compute the minor allele frequency at each SNP of each allele. So once you have cleaned your data, you have a genotype file, a phenotype file, and you will merge both to compute and to perform finally the GWAS. So the statistical method that can be used in a GWAS depend on the study design. Do we have access to case control data or family data? Are we interested in a binary tree or quantitative tree or a time to onset? Or time to disease onset. The standard methods used in GWAS are regression models because it can be logistic linear or linear mixed model. Because these regression models have the advantage that they can include more than one predictor in a regression equation. In fact, when you test the effect of a SNP on the disease status, you can adjust this effect, you can incorporate in the regression model different covariates, lifestyle and environmental covariates that are known to influence the disease status. And you will incorporate the genetic principal component too to adjust for population substructure. Then you will test the effect of the SNP on the disease status by performing a wall test. As in GWAS, we tested 500,000 SNPs. We have to use transgene threshold to declare a signal genome-wide significant. And usually, the threshold that is used is a p-value for the SNP effect of 5 × 10⁻⁸. Of note, I just want to note that in the majority of GWAS are, in the majority, a single marker analysis. You consider one SNP at a time. And we will go back on that with the presentation of Florence. Once the GWAS has been performed, you will check for deviation between observed and expected null SNP disease association. You will compute what we call a genomic inflation factor, defined as the ratio of the median of the empirical observed distribution of the test statistic to the expected median. And you can use this inflation factor to correct the standard error of your SNP effect and to recompute the statistical test of your GWAS. To present a GWAS result, the easy way is a visualization method called a Manhattan plot, where you plot minus log 10 p-value of the SNP effect, the statistical test of the SNP effect, along the genome. So each dot represents a statistical test, and you look at the results that reach the genome-wide significance level threshold. And what is often observed in associated region is that the lead SNP at a given region associated locus is accompanied by many adjacent SNP and they might show association. This adjacent SNP may show association because of the LD structure, the LD, the linkage disequilibrium with the lead SNP. The power of GWAS relies on two main characteristics: a screening at high level of resolution and a large sample size. To increase the SNP density, we can use imputation. To increase sample size, we can use a statistical tool called meta-analysis. And so we can act on these two characteristics to increase the power of GWAS. Imputation. So imputation are done to increase SNP density. Impute allele, the strategy is to impute alleles for all missing SNPs, then analyze them as if they were in fact genotyped. It's a way, in fact, to combine a different study through meta-analysis that have been genotyped using different array. So studies that have different information across the genome, so different SNP genotype across the genome. To compute imputation, you need to have access to reference panel, so such as the 1000 genome or the haplotype reference consortium. So the principle of genotype imputation is to use a sparse set of genotypes, GWAS genotyping, and haplotype structure of existing samples, such as 1000 genome samples, to infer data for sample with sparse markers. On the first step, you will identify region of chromosome shared between the study sample, the observed genotype, and individuals from the reference haplotype, the reference panel. Then, each study sample is phased, and the haplotypes are modeled as a mosaic of those in the haplotype reference panel. programs are mainly used to impute genotype data, impute and minimac. Both methods are hidden Markov model-based methods. For this method, impute and minimac, and with this method, you can, in fact, impute the whole genome. But you have some specific program to impute the HLA region. The imputation, you can do the imputation on your own server, or you can use free genotype imputation service, such as the Michigan Imputer Server or the Sanger Imputation Server. So when you have done imputation, you have access to the same data on the whole genome in different studies. You can combine results across study and so increase the power for detecting significant results and decrease the uncertainty of the estimated genetic risk. And the statistical methods used in meta-analysis depends on the type of available data, the statistical model used to perform GWAS, and also summary statistics shared by collaborative group. As we have seen that statistical model that is mainly used in GWAS is regression models, you will have probably access to regression coefficient and standard error of the SNP effect on the disease. So you can compute meta-analysis using fixed effect models, what we call inverse variance weighted model, or a random effect models. Fixed effect model assumes that observed effects are estimates of a single effect. Average effects are computed by weighting each study's regression coefficient according to the inverse variance, to the inverse of their sampling variance. And this method has been extended to random effect model by incorporating in the sampling variance, an interstudy variance plus the intrastudy variance. And this random effect model allows for effect to vary across studies. So in the following slide, I will give you some example of how imputation and meta-analysis can increase the potential of GWAS to detect associated variant to asthma. One of the first meta-analyses that had been performed worldwide was performed in the context of Gabriel Consortium, an EU-funded consortium, where that gathered more than 20 studies, including only individuals of European ancestry. This meta-analysis include more than 10,000 asthmatic cases and more than 16,000 controls. And this GWAS performed in 2010, with genotyped data. No imputed data, and lead to the identification of six asthma loci. Several years later, a multi-ancestry meta-analysis of asthma was performed in the context of the TAXI consortium. And in this meta-analysis, population of European ancestry were analyzed and combined with population of African, Japanese, and Latino ancestry. More than 20,000 asthmatic subjects were analyzed, and more than 118,000 controls were included. And this is the largest meta-analysis that had been performed on asthma GWAS, has identified more than 800 SNPs that were associated with asthma at a genome-wide significance level. Another way to increase the sample size for GWAS is to use biobanks. On this slide, I indicate some of the biobanks that are available worldwide. Many more exist. So one of the most used, I would say, biobank in GWAS is the UK biobank. And last year, GWAS of asthma was performed using UK biobank data. But when you use a biobank, you have to keep in mind that often you, in fact, you consider a single population, in fact. In the UK biobank data for asthma, only subjects of European ancestry were analyzed. More than almost 40,000 asthmatic cases were analyzed, with more than 300,000 controls. And this large study led to the identification of 61 distinct asthma loci. So, what did GWAS bring? In fact, GWAS were successful to identify many new loci associated with many traits or disease. As illustrated with this photo, where each dot represents an association signal. Each dot is retrieved from the GWAS catalog. Each dot represents an association signal found, a SNP found associated with a given disease at a genome-wide significant level. And in the GWAS catalog, almost 200,000 of variant-tree associations are available. So GWAS brings new biological hypotheses regarding pathophysiological mechanisms underlying disease. GWAS have also shown that distinct disease or traits thought to be biologically unrelated often share association with genetic variants more often than expected by chance. And we call that pleiotropy. And we'll illustrate that with an example of asthma. The member of the TAXE consortium searched for overlap between asthma loci and GWAS catalog signals. And they searched for overlap doing some enrichment analysis. And this analysis identify significant overlap of asthma loci with loci underlying immune-related disease, but that was expected for disease like asthma, but also with other disease with an inflammatory component like cardiovascular, neuropsychiatric, or cancer disease. Finally, what is the biological role of GWAS variant? So what is the biological role of variants that have been found through GWAS? Indeed, once a GWAS has been performed, additional steps are required to identify the causal variant and the target genes in a given genomic region. But this identification can be difficult because previous studies have shown that more than 90% of GWAS variants map to non-coding regions, and half of them map, in fact, to intergenic region. So it may be difficult to identify which gene and which genetic variant is involved in a given in the susceptibility of a given disease. Moreover, when we look at the regional plot, where we can see that many genes underlying association signal in a given region. So in such region, what is the causal SNP? What is the target gene? GWAS studies have shown that GWAS variant may mostly reside in gene regulatory region. So the incorporation of functional annotation to interpret GWAS results will be a useful tool. And the functional annotation that we can incorporate are EQTL, expression quantitative Trello site data, so expression data. Many databases with expression data are available. And we can use also regulatory elements such as epigenetic marks. And I will give you different examples how to incorporate such data, such a functional annotation. So one way is to integrate GWAS and expression data. Among the different databases that are publicly available with expression data and EQTL data, there is the Genotype Tissue Expression Project that was launched in 2010. The aim of this project is to build a catalog of genetic effects on gene expression of expression across a large number of tissue. The specificity of this the project of Datadesk is that it gathers many tissues, the expression data gene expression data measure in different tissue from same donor, At least EQTL data, EQTL analysis have been performed for 49 tissue. And this analysis, we have to keep in mind when using this GTEC data that the donor, the people where this tissue were extracted, are deceased deaf people, deceased person, more often male, with an age more than 16 years old, and most of them are of European descent. This data, the JTEC project, has identified that more than 90% of the common variants show nominal association with the expression level of at least one gene in at least one tissue. They have identified that also that the gene expression is tissue and cell specific. And then more than one third of genes show sex bias expression in at least one tissue. So when we want to use expression data, we have to pay attention on the tissue we choose to examine regarding the disease we are studying. So one way to integrate GWAS and EQTL results is to perform co-localization analysis. The principle of this co-localization analysis is to estimate the posterior probability that the same variant is causal in both a GWAS and an EQTL study, while accounting for the uncertainty on the linkage disequilibrium. The statistical methods are mainly based on Bayesian statistical framework and of note, these methods are applied to summary association statistics. You don't need to have access to the raw data. And Bayesian method derives the posterior support for each of the five hypotheses, describing the possible association of the region with both HGWAS and EQTL. You can consider that there is no causal variant for either three in the region you are interested in, or there is a causal variant for the disease association for the GWAS result, a causal variant for the gene expression association, so the EQTL result only. There are two distinct causal variants in the study region, one for each trait, or what is more interesting, there is a single causal variant common to both traits, and we call that co-localization. So we use such method, co-localization method, to explore the association signal that was found with asthma in the 5Q31 region in the TAXI consortium. GWAS, meta-analysis of GWAS. And here, on the top right, you have in that region the lead SNP of the the asthma GWAS. On the bottom, you have the lead SNP of the EQTL analysis, the lead SNP, in fact, of the expression level of the transcript of NDFIP1. And doing colocalization, we evidenced that this last SNP, so the EQTL lead SNP, has the highest colocalization posterior probability, so it's probably the causal SNP in that region. And this SNP, in fact, is so an EQTL for NDFIP1 that is involved in negative regulation, in negative regulatory function, that has a negative regulatory function in IgE-dependent mast cell activity, a key mechanism in allergic asthma. Different methods can be used to integrate EQTL data. In the context of the TAXE consortium, they use a conditional analysis to dissect a complex region associated with asthma, the 70Q12Q21 region. In that region, in fact, two measures associated SNP were identified. One in the wall samples, and this signal was located in the ERBBB2-PGAP3 region. And the second signal was located in the ORMDL3 region, but was found in the pediatric subgroup. It means it was found for childhood onset asthma. And these two regions are located, and the ORMDL3 region is located 180 kb far from the first region. So in that paper, they perform conditional analysis using lead asthma GWAS SNP and peak EQTL SNP with the gene transcript blood and lung tissue, and they identify that the lead pediatric asthma SNP accounts for association of the peak SNP with ORMDL3 transcript in blood, while the asthma EAT, the EAT SNP found in the whole population, accounts for the association of peak SNP with PGAP transcript in lung. So this analysis identify that asthma-associated signals near these two blocks may affect asthma risk through the expression of different genes in different tissues. Finally, functional annotation of disease association loci can also be done by integrating genetic and epigenetic data. And we'll show you how the integration of DNA variation and epigenetic data helps pinpointing a gene involved in the combined asthma plus rhinitis phenotype. Epigenetic mechanisms such as DNA methylation, histone modification, or miRNA are involved in the regulation of gene expression. And it has been shown that epigenetics play a role in immune response and thus potentially in asthma. Among the different epigenetic mechanisms, there is imprinting, so genomic imprinting. Genomic imprinting can be defined as the effect of an allele at given loci on the disease differ according to to whom has transmitted this allele. So if the pair, for example, the allele was transmitted by the father, this allele can have an effect, whereas if it is transmitted by the mother, it has no effect on the disease. The conversely can be also found. So in a given analysis, we have a study. In fact, we have searched for genetic variants that were associated with asthma and allergic rhinitis. First, we perform a genome-wide linkage analysis in European families. We identify a region that was linked to asthma plus rhinitis phenotype under a parent of origin effect. We find map this region, and study association and perform association analysis with SNP, that region, in a discovery sample and replication sample that only include families. And finally, we select associated SNP with asthma plus rhinitis phenotype under a parent-origin effect, and for this SNP, we test association with DNA methylation in the same French-Canadian family that participate to the step two. And we perform causal inference test to investigate whether the association between the SNP and the phenotype can be explained by DNA methylation. So first we can perform a linkage analysis of asthma and rhinitis and identify a region located on the chromosome 4 that was linked to the asthma plus rhinitis phenotype. And we observe an increased evidence for linkage on DNA marker with disease when taking account parent of origin effect. In that case, transmission of the risk allele from the father. Then, in that region of the four Q region, we perform association analysis of asthma plus rhinitis with more than 1,000 SNPs. Once again, this association analysis were performed by taking into account parent of origin effect. And we identify through the pool analysis of the EG and CLG families that a marker located near the MTNR1A gene is associated with the asthma plus rhinitis phenotype. And what we identify is that the paternally transmitted G allele of the SNP RS1000914 is associated with asthma plus rhinitis phenotype. So, and at the first step, we conduct association analysis of DNA methylation with this particular allele under an imprinting model. And we use the French-Canadian family, some of the French-Canadian families to explore this association. And we found an association of this particular allele when it's transmitted by the father with the methylation at a particular gene CpG site. And there was no association of this allele when it was transmitted by the mother. So, performing this association of DNA methylation level with SNP, we were able to identify a paternally transmitted variant, GLL, that is associated with DNA methylation level at a CpG site. And we also tested the association of the CpG site with the disease. And we found that this methylation is associated with the disease. So finally, to understand, to explore whether the DNA methylation mediates the association between the SNP and the phenotype, we conduct conditional causal inference test by performing four conditions. First, we have shown that the SNP and the G allele at the SNP is associated with the phenotype. Then, we show that this NIP is associated with the level of methylation at this CpG site, even if when I will say when this NIP is associated with the CpG site, even when adjusting for the phenotype. On the first step, we show that this DNA methylation is associated with the phenotype, but and it's associated, this association is kept when adjusting for G. And finally, the last test we perform is to search whether the GLL of the SNP is associated with the disease when conditioning on the methylation. And what we show is that we no more see the association when we adjust for methylation. So we have doing this causal inference test, we have shown that the effect of the paternally transmitted SNP G allele on asthma plus rhinitis phenotypes is mediated by differential DNA methylation. So by integrating genetic and epigenetic data, our study has demonstrated that a differentially methylated CpG site within the MTNR1A gene mediates the effect of a paternally transmitted allele genetic variant on asthma and allergic rhinitis comorbidity. The MTNR1A gene is of particular of interest in asthma because it expresses in lung VNT cell. It involves melatonin action, and melatonin has an immunomodulatory effect in allergic disease. So MTNR1 is a good candidate gene for asthma and rhinitis. So now I will let now Florence will continue the presentation.
So I am going now to talk about the post-GWAS strategy. So as Emmanuel said, what did GWAS bring? They brought many loci associated with many traits, and all these loci are listed in the GWAS catalog. An important finding of GWAS is that SNP or genes common to various traits are more often than expected to suggesting pleiotropy. And also it generated a new biological hypothesis, new pathological mechanism. GWAS have brought a wealth of information, but GWAS are based on single SNP analysis, as Emmanuel I told you. So the SNP with low marginal effect or interacting with other gene environmental factors may be missed. GWAS SNPs, it's one of the main findings and explain only part of the disease heritability. And biological of the disease-associated variant are mostly unknown. Although Emmanuel gave you two examples where it was possible to infer the causal variant, in many cases, I mean, it's progressing right now, but in many instances, we don't know what the target gene or what the causal variant. So there is a need to develop strategy and method that allow integrating biological knowledge, such as pathway-based or network-based method, to test for gene-gene and gene-environment interaction, and also what can be the use of this GWAS. I will show at the end that GWAS summary statistic can be used for disease risk prediction. And this is very hot topic right now. So in my presentation, I will show that integrating GWAS outcome and pathway information can lead to the identification of pathway enriched in disease genes, so to provide some biological insight and also to facilitate the detection of gene-gene interaction. Then network analysis of GWAS outcomes can lead to the identification of interconnected gene module influencing the disease. And finally, I will present what are polygenic risk scores that enables to improve disease risk prediction. So the principle of pathway analysis is to integrate so the GWAS summary statistic with pathway. So as input, you have your single SNP results, so your p-value from your GWAS. Then the next step is to map SNP to gene using genome assembly and SNP position, then to compute a gene statistic, then to map your gene to your pathway, for example, gene ontology category, to compute the pathway statistic, which is an enrichment score, and then to compute the significance of your enrichment score for permutation. So mapping SNP to gene, the most common way of doing is to use location. So to map SNPs if they belong to genes, so within gene boundaries, or to use also to extend the location 20 kb or 50 kb from the gene boundaries. But also we can locate the SNPs based on linkage degree pattern, or more and more now it's proposed to locate, to map the genes using functional annotation, but this is sometimes quite difficult to do this at the genome-wide level. To compute a gene statistic, there are various methods which have been proposed. We can take the best SNP statistic within the gene, but as you know, because of the LD pattern, we have to compute empirical p-value through permutation. It's possible also to combine the different SNP statistics in a gene, for example, to take all the SNP in a gene, or the best SNP in a gene, or a set of genes meeting a given threshold. But also we have to correct for the correlation between SNP, and there is a package which is called Vegas, which can do that. Or it's possible also to use the raw data. In terms of pathway, we can have access to many databases. One of the common one, which is mostly used, is the Gene Ontology, which is a collection of structured vocabulary. The issue is it's kind of a tree with many gene ontology categories connected to each other. There is a high redundancy of gene set. So in some package, we have to choose this tree at a given level, for example, the level 4 of the gene ontology database. There is another also well-known pathway database which is used is a KEG, and which is made of functional pathway, metabolic pathway, between indicating the relationship between genes. And there is also the MCDB, which is the molecular signature database, which aggregates indeed data from gene ontology KEG, but also other databases such as BioCarta and Reactome. So to compute the pathway statistic, it's an enrichment score. So you have your GWAS SNPs which have been mapped to the gene. So here in red are the genes belonging to a given pathway. So you rank your genes according to to the strength of their association with the disease, going from the most strongly associated to the least associated. And then if the gene is part of the pathway, the enrichment score is increased, and the increase is proportional to the gene statistic. Whereas if the gene does not belong to the pathway, here, for example, P3 does not belong to the pathway, so the enrichment score is decreased, and this decrease is proportional to the number of genes which do not belong to the pathway. So you do that along the list of genes. You have your enrichment score, which is either increasing or decreasing, and it reaches the maximum, and you stop when it reaches the maximum, and the genes driving the enrichment of the pathway are called leading genes. So, but there are two issues. The enrichment score is influenced by the size of the pathway, the number of genes in the pathway, but also the non-independence of genes. For example, we know that there are gene clusters, genes which are located close to each other because they have the same function, for example, in the case of the HLA region. There is a second issue, which is multiple testing. Like for the SNPs, we have many pathways which are tested, so there is a multiple testing due to the number of pathways tested, but also the non-independence between pathways, because pathways share genes. There are genes which belong to very certain number of type of pathway. So it's we have to go through permutation to compute empirical p-value. So we have to generate the null distribution of end response score using permutation, for example, 100,000 permutations or more. We can normalize the end response score by computing, by removing, I mean, the mean and dividing by standard deviation obtained under the null distribution. And we can compute the empirical significance and then do multiple testing correction by computing the false discovery rate. There are different types of permutation which can be done. The gold standard is to use phenotype permutation. So if you have access to the raw data, it's possible to do it, but you need to have access to the phenotypic and genotypic data. And very often people, it's difficult to share this data, so we don't have to have access. We can't have access to this data, and also it's highly time consuming. We could do permutation of SNP statistics. So this is computationally efficient, but this does not preserve the linkage disequilibrium among SNP or the correlation among functionally related genes which are located close to each other on the genome. We can also use gene statistics, which is also computationally efficient, but it ignores the variation of number of SNPs assigned to a gene. So there have been comparisons which have been made for simulation of these three types of permutation, and it showed that the gene statistic permutation does not perform well. There is an inflated type 1 error rate, whereas the SNP permutation provides results more similar to the phenotype permutation. There is a method, very interesting method, which has been proposed by Cabrera and colleagues, which is called circular genomic permutation. And that method allows to preserve the linkage disequilibrium pattern and the clustering of genes. Indeed, they consider the genome as being circular, and SNPs are ordered according to their genomic position. And you can generate circular genomic permutation by rotating single SNP statistics with respect to their genomic location. Some postdoctoral students in my lab, Myriam Brossard and Amaury Weiss, They compare this type of permutation, the circular genomic permutation to phenotype permutation and SNP permutation, and they found that circular permutation were performing much better than the SNP permutation, and they provided similar results to the phenotype permutation. So this is the type of method now we are using. I will provide now, present an example. We apply this pathway-based analysis to two melanoma GWAS, which have been conducted in the French dataset, the Melaris Consortium, included 4,000 individuals, and a US dataset, the MD Anderson Cancer Study dataset, which included almost 10,000 individuals. So there were some common signal, association signal on the genome between these two GWAS. But we wanted to see what was going on at the pathway level. So the data were imputed using the HapMap3 software, you know, using imputation as Emmanuel has talked about before. The SNPs were assigned to 20,000, were assigned to genes. There were 20,000 genes with SNPs, then to gene ontology category. And finally, there were 316 GO in one dataset, scandal 19 in the other dataset. We found that there were GO which made the false discovery rate less than 5%, 28 in Melarix, 27 in MDAC, and five of them were shared by the two datasets. Three of these pathways were known to be involved in melanoma, response to light stimulus, because melanoma is a cutaneous cancer, and we know that exposure to UV sun exposure is very important, so the gene involved in that pathway where most of them, I mean, this pathway is known to be associated with melanoma. Also, regulation of mitotic cell cycle, there are well-known genes, CDK and 2A, which belong to that pathway, which is also known to predispose to melanoma. induction of programmed cell death is also known to be associated with melanoma, but at the time, these two pathways were not known to be associated with melanoma, cytokine activity and oxidative phosphorylation. And what was interesting is that cytokine activity, you know, it's the immune response. And we know now that there is a success of the development of immunotherapy in melanoma. So we found that this finding was interesting. And also oxidative phosphorylation, the recent GWAS of melanoma also now point to genes involved in that pathway. Pathway analysis so can pinpoint, can provide information on the pathways which are biologically relevant in the disease, but also can be used to detect gene-gene interaction. If you test, and I will show you that in a slide, gene-gene interaction at the genome-wide level, the threshold to declare a gene-gene interaction is at the order of 10 to the minus 12 or 15. You know, for single-chip analysis, it was 10 to the minus 8. Here, you have to be even more stringent. So it's really rare. It's very difficult to detect gene-gene interaction at the genome-wide level if you do that analysis by itself. But if you do it within a pathway-based analysis framework, this will facilitate the detection of gene-gene interaction. So we did that in these two data sets, Melarisk and MDAC. We test for C-SNP interaction using the InterSNP software. You have a logistic model in which you have the SNP1 effect, the SNP2 effect, plus an interaction term. We selected the SNP pair with a p-value for interaction of 10^-4. We follow up this SNP in the MDAC dataset, and then we perform a meta-analysis of the interaction effect. And we evaluated the statistical significance through a hierarchical procedure to correct for multiple testing. So because the SNPs are correlated, similarly, the SNP pairs are also correlated, and so we have to compute the number of independent SNP pairs. For that, we use an extension of the MEF approach. This approach has been developed for single SNP, and we extended that to the correlation matrix of interaction term. Now, for the single SNP, it does a principal component analysis of the LD matrix, and it uses this principal component to compute the effective number of independent SNPs. Here, we did the same to compute the effective number of independent SNP pairs. Then we computed the threshold for significance for a given pathway by dividing using the Bonferroni correction, by dividing the 5% level by the sum of effective number of C pairs for a given gene pair and summing over all gene pairs within the pathway. So this is the T pathway threshold. And then because we had 5 pathways which were significant for the 2 data sets, we computed the overall threshold, which is the threshold for the pathway divided by the number of pathways tested. So this is to show you the gain of using that strategy as opposed to the genome-wide GWI study, genome-wide interaction study over the genome. If we had considered all possible C pairs across the genome, the threshold would be 5^-14. If we had considered all the SNP pairs over the 5 pathways, it would be 10^-9. The effective number of C pairs over the 5 pathways, 2.5 × 10^-8. And if we use a hierarchical correction, we had a p-value, we have a threshold for the p-value between 3^-7 to 7^-9, which varies according to the size of the pathway. So by using that procedure, we were able to detect a significant SNP pair over the 5 million SNP pair tested in the regulation mitotic cell cycle GEO. The SNPs belong to two genes, TERF1 and AFT1L2. And as you can see on this slide, the interaction, indeed, when the, you have the risk for the AFP1L2 gene, it increases when the genotype at the TERF1 gene is TT, whereas it decreases when the genotype at the TERF1 gene is CC. So it's called a flip-flop, you know, an inverse flip-flop pattern of interaction. And these two genes have biological relevance. Indeed, TERF1 is involved in the, it's a telomeric repeat binding factor. It's involved in the sheltering complex, which is a complex of genes of protein, which are at the telomere, at the end of the chromosome, and are involved in the telomere biology, which is known to play a major role in aging, but also it's associated with many cancer. And at the time, it was an emerging process in melanoma. And the other gene is an actin filament-associated protein, and it promotes the growth of cancer cells. And interestingly, we found a paper where there was a screening experiment of 12,000 proteins, which reported, in fact, an interaction between these two proteins, thus confirming our result with our strategy. This is to show that it's very interesting to use a complementary strategy to discover the gene in a complex disease such as melanoma. Indeed, these are the genes of the sheltering complex I talked about. There are six genes involved in the sheltering complex. Some of these genes were discovered by exome sequencing in familial melanoma, so only in families showing familial aggregation of melanoma, TERF2-1P, ACD, and POT1. The TERF1 was found by the pathway and gene-gene interaction analysis, and these genes also interact with TERF, which was discovered by GWAS. So this shows that by combining different strategies, exome sequencing, GWAS, pathway, and gene-gene interaction analysis, you are able progressively to disentangle the mechanism underlying a complex disease. The second strategy is a network analysis. So this analysis, you can integrate biological knowledge, for example, human protein interaction within a network with GWAS results, single SNP p-value, to find a sub-network, a gene module enriched in association signal. And I will present an example also for asthma, childhood asthma, using the data from the Gabriel Consortium. And this was done by Yuan Long Liu, which was a previous student in the MLPM network. And indeed, the rationale for this type of network analysis is the guilt by association. Genes are interconnected in a network. Genes interconnected in a network are thought to be more likely to share similar functions and thus to be involved in the disease process. So the goal is to find some network enriched in disease-associated genes. So we use a GWAS outcome from the Gabriel Asthma Consortium that Emmanuel has already presented. We focus on childhood onset asthma, and there were, we decided to split, there were 18 childhood onset asthma studies. We decided to split into two data sets, a data set with 9 studies and another data set of the remaining 9 studies. There were about 3,000 cases, 3,000 control in each set, because we wanted to be, I will show you, to be able to use these two data sets separately in order to find consistent results. And the meta-analysis included 2.5 million SNPs, which are imputed using the HapMap2 panel. The protein network which was used was the PINA platform, which integrates 6 public curated databases showing protein-protein interaction. Altogether, there are 17,000 proteins and 166,000 interaction pairs. So the main, the overview of that of the network analysis is to assign, as for pathway, SNP2 gene to get a gene-based p-value and then load this gene-based p-value on the network. So to weight the PINA network. Then to select within this score network, the sum network, so to search then the module within each dataset, then to select the modules which are shared by the two datasets and intersect these gene modules, then evaluate the significance for permutation. So for each, we assign SNP to gene according to their location as for the pathway, but it would be possible in the future to use also functional annotation and EQTL. We corrected for computing the gene statistic, we use the best tip p-value, but we corrected that value to take into account the gene length and LD pattern using the circular genomic permutation I presented before. And you are long, you know, sometimes it takes time because you have to compute 100,000 or more permutation. And Yuan Long has developed an exact algorithm that is implemented in a fast CGP, which is available on GitHub, and which can be used very easily to get the corrected p-value. For to select the sum network, we use a dense module search algorithm, which has been proposed by Gia and colleague. And for that, we have to compute the module score. The module score is the sum of the gene weight being derived from the p-value, divided by the square root of the number of genes. So you start with a C gene in your genome, and you add the direct interactor to the module up, and you compute at each time the module score. If the module score increases by at least 10%, you continue, and if it's less than 10%, you stop. You do that for each, you start from each seed. I mean, you use all the genes you have in your gene network, and so you have many modules at the end. So you do that, we did that in the data set one, we did that in the data set two, but as I told you, there are many modules which are generated in each set. So we computed all pairwise module similarity, and we selected the module which were most similar across the two data sets. So modules showing consistent results across the two data sets. We selected the 10 most similar modules, and then we intersected this selected module in order to have a consistent sum network from both datasets. We computed the module significance for permutation, first the significance of the module score compared with the background network, and also the significance of the association of the module score with ASMA, by doing circular genomic permutation as before. What we found, we identified a network including 91 genes, which was significantly associated with ASMA at the 10^-5 level. This module score included 19 genes which are associated with ASMA at the nominal p-value in both in the two datasets. There were 13 were already known and 6 new genes. As you see on this slide, this network has a very interesting structure. There was a core network, and in this core network, all the genes in red are known genes, which were very well known genes associated with ASMA on three different loci, some on the chromosome 17, that Emmanuel has presented, GSDMA, GSDMB, ORMDL3, another one on chromosome 9, IL33, and some other on chromosome 2, IL18 RAP. So all these known genes were connected to the APP gene, which is known to be a gene predisposing to Alzheimer's disease, amyloid beta protein gene. And so I will discuss this finding later on because we found this was interesting. And besides this core subnetwork, there were 5 peripheral networks which were all connected to the core network and which were also meaningful functionally. And some of the genes in blue are new genes which have a biological function relevant for asthma. So we were struck indeed by this finding that the asthma, known asthma genes were all connected to the APP genes. And then when we searched for the literature, we found that indeed there are several lines of evidence showing relationship between asthma and Alzheimer's disease. Epidemiological studies have reported an increased risk of Alzheimer's disease in patients with asthma. There are some genetic factors involved in Alzheimer's disease which are immune-related or involved in inflammatory process. There are also epigenetic signatures found in a mouse model of AD which indicate that the two main pathways are neuronal and immune response. And also an asthma drug was found to have a beneficial impact on AD in an AD mouse model. So all this line of evidence indicate that there may be some pleiotropy between asthma and Alzheimer's disease. And there are more and more indeed studies now showing that immune-related mechanisms are important in both psychiatric and neurodegenerative disease. When we did then a functional analysis using the DAVID package in order to find functionally related module, we found four functional related modules. The immune response in black, which is spread out across the whole network. And we find three other functional modules, which indeed were co-localized exactly with the sub-network identified. For example, in red, this is a chemokine cluster, which is also relevant for asthma. They are all here. In green, the cadherin cell adhesion cluster, which is known also to play a role in asthma through the role in the epithelium barrier. And in that cluster, there are some genes, for example, like MYC-B and MYC-A, which have been indeed found later on to be associated with asthma. And also the zinc finger transcription factor, which may play a role in the regulation of gene regulation. So indeed, network analysis allows to identify new candidate genes that were not detected by the GWAS, but they need to be confirmed by follow-up study. As I told you, some of them now have confirmed some of these genes. The core asthma genes were connected to APP showing pleiotropy, and functional analysis revealed four gene clusters which are biological, meaningful for asthma. So generated new hypotheses that can be further validated by functional study. Finally, I will discuss how GWAS summary statistics can be used to compute polygenic risk score and how they can contribute to predict disease risk. A polygenic risk score is a weighted sum of the risk allele an individual carries, the weight being the SNP effect size estimated by a previous GWAS. So PRS is the sum of the allele count for an individual E and SNP J, beta being the effect size estimate from a GWAS. The classical method used to compute PRS is called clumping thresholding. You have to sum over all independent SNPs, so you have to do some clumping in order to eliminate SNPs which are in linkage disequilibrium, and it is not known which set of SNPs should be used, either the SNP over the whole genome or the SNP meeting the genome-wide significant level or intermediate number of SNPs. So indeed, people have proposed to try different thresholds in order to select the PRS providing the best prediction accuracy. But other methods have been also developed, proposed based on penalized regression to take into account the LDB3 SNP. It's implemented in the LassoSum software. Also a Bayesian approach, which is also used broadly, which is the LDPRED software. and extension of feldiprene have been recently proposed to integrate functional annotation. So the first use of the PRS was done indeed a long time ago by Purcell for schizophrenia. At the time, in GWAS, no SNP was meeting the genome level. So he assumed that the schizophrenia was rather polygenic due to a large number of SNPs with small effect. So he constructed the PRS in a first schizophrenia study and tested for the PRS in a second one and was able to show association between that PRS and schizophrenia. That was used also to detect pleiotropy by constructing a PRS using GWAS results from schizophrenia. That PRS was found associated with bipolar disorder, so showing a common genetic contribution between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. But now, PRS are mainly used to predict risk. One of the first examples which led to some interesting results was the one computed for coronary heart disease, which showed that the PRS was able to identify individuals with high risk equivalent to monogenic mutation. So for that, in that study, the PRS was derived using GWAS summary statistics and LD reference panel using 1,000 genome European data. They computed 31 candidate scores based on the clumping thresholding method, but also an LDPRED. Then they computed these 31 PRS in the UK Biobank phase one data, including 120,000 individuals, and they choose the best PRS based providing the maximal area under the curve. Then they tested that PRS in the UK Biobank phase two, and they assessed the association of the best PRS with the disease. As you see in this slide, to get good PRS, you have to have large data set for your GWAS and large data set for your testing data set. And when they computed the odd ratio at different threshold, they divided the PRS into percentile. And when they look at the top 1% as compared to the remaining 99%, they found an odd ratio of 4.8, which was highly significant. And as you see, the odd ratio is increasing depending on the threshold you use to select your individual according to their PRS value. Recently, you know, there are many studies. It's a very topic. Many people are computing PRS for a large number of diseases. This was done with a function which can predict risk of COPD. COPD is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. It's defined by a low FEV1 over FVC. These are measures of lung function. FEV1 is forced expiratory volume in 1 second. FVC is forced vital capacity. They used a very large GWAS data, Spirometa, which is an international consortium, and they merged that with the UK Biobank. They were using in the GWAS data 7 million SNPs. They derived their PRS in one data set using the lasso-sum method. There were 1.57 million SNPs for the FEV1 PRS, 1.2 million for the other lung function measure. And when they combined the PRS from the two measures, FEV1 divided by FVC, they have the PRS of 2.5 million SNPs. And they tested that PRS in 9 population-based and case-control studies. They found that the odd ratio for COPD, for each decile, they computed the odd ratio for each decile versus the first decile, and they observed an odd ratio for the last decile of 7.9 as compared to the first decile in European ancestry individual and 4.8 in non-European individual. Indeed, the GWAS are computed mainly in European subject, so they cannot be applied. I mean, they can provide not so good results in non-European population, so their efforts have to be made to get more data in non-European ancestry individual. And this is in the bottom, this is to show that PRS can improve disease risk prediction, but other risk factors have to be taken into account. Classical clinical risk factors have to be taken into account. In that case, it was HCHEC and smoking. So in green, the PRS, blue risk factor, red PRS plus risk factor. And as you can see, the AUC is always better when you use both PRS plus risk factor. So to conclude, so we can use of PRS in disease prediction for prevention strategy. For example, for COPD, we can reinforce smoking cessation in those with high PRS. Use of PRS in treatment choice. For example, it has been shown that there is a better efficacy of statin in subjects with high genetic risk for cardiovascular disease, but a lot of development has to be made. These are very, you know, this is one example, but right now it's not well known how PRS can be used in choice of treatment. And also PRS can be used to refine penetrance of high-risk variant, but PRS has also limitation. As I pointed out, there is heterogeneity of data. So it depends on in which data set you have computed, you have done your GWAS. So depending on the ethnicity and the environment, lifestyle factor of the individual and may not be applied right away to another population. Careful evaluation of the value of the PRS is needed before using it in personalized medicine. And also it's important to combine PRS probably with other clinical and environmental risk factors. So in conclusion, GWAS data provide a wealth of information. GWAS data coupled with biological information can provide insight into the biological mechanism. And PRS may contribute to disease prevention and therapeutic intervention, but needs right now to be used with caution. So I acknowledge, you know, the various groups which have been involved in the study we have presented, Emmanuel and myself, and our sponsor. Thank you very much.
We thank you, Emmanuel and Florence, for this presentation. That was wonderful. Now it's time for questions. So are there any questions from the network at the moment? Please raise your hand if so. Yeah, so there's one. Giovanni, please go ahead.
Hi, thank you again for the talk. So the question that I have is probably very basic, but you mentioned that you often make testable predictions that need to be validated. Mm. What does the validation process usually look like? Is it in vitro validation? Is it additional population studies?
Right now, the validation is mainly statistics, but it could be done also, you know, it's true, using experiment, but it's done, it's statistical. It's AUC, or to know if it improves the prediction or computing a ratio, it's done like that at a statistical level.
Thank you.
Thank you. There is a question from Slido. I think it is for Emmanuel. Thanks for the talk. Is the distribution of GWAS hits between coding and non-coding regions different than expected by chance? That was posted during Emmanuel's part of the talk. So it's probably addressed to you.
Yeah, sorry. There were some works in the building, so it's difficult to hear. But I think I hear the question. In fact, the fact that we found some association signals more in a non-coding region was really a new result. It was not expected that, because we were thinking on Mendelian disease, where in fact, the effect of a variant on is due to a change of the protein structure. And with GWAS result, in fact, that we found the result outside gene and within gene, but in non-regulatory, within gene in non-coding region, but in regulatory region, it expected that this region, this NIP, in fact, will alter the gene expression level and not the structure.
Good, thank you. Is there another question from the network? Yes, Lucas, please go ahead.
Hello, thank you very much for your very interesting talk. I just have a question out of curiosity. As you mentioned, the quality and the generalizability of the results that you get from this kind of analysis depends on the amount and the quality of the data that you collect. And all the biobanks and data centers I know are in developed countries. So I wanted to know if you know of any initiative from third world countries that are generating data of this kind. That's the question.
I can answer about that indeed, right now in the US, because of the PRS, they realize it cannot be applied well to, you know, non-European population. So they make effort now to develop research, at least in the US. These are not, you know, these are admixed population, but they develop effort in the US to get more and more data in African-American, Latinos, and so on, so in admixed population. But I guess there will be also some effort developed perhaps in Africa. There is a lot of effort developed, for example, it's not in Asia. In China and in Japan, there are, you know, very important effort for getting biobank. So Asian population are covered. The issue is for Africa, but they are developed in collaboration, yes, with UK or US collaborators.
Thank you
very much.
I don't see a new question on Slido. Is there another one from the network? If not, then I may take the opportunity and ask Florence one question. Florence, when you perform a network GWAS, you describe this principle very well, and you do not find anything. It could be that either the network is of too poor quality, that you don't know the network structure well enough. It could also be that your genetic sample, like the number of individuals, is too small to find a strong association. So there may be data sets where you don't find a network GWAS hit now, but over time, as network data gets better or as genetic data sets gets larger, you suddenly discover something. I wondered whether you have ever seen such a scenario where over time, with the data set growing or the network data getting better, you suddenly get a network GWAS hit that you didn't observe in the first place.
I did not observe that, but I think what you say, yes, I think so. Of course, if you increase your biological knowledge, more and more information you will have. Indeed, as you know, Yuan Long used another method, SIGMOD. He applied to string. For example, here he used protein-protein interaction, but there are other networks which include protein interaction, gene expression, text mining. So more and more information you use, you have better chance, for example, to find a network. But also you have to use accurate information. The issue is that sometimes text mining is an interesting method, but the relationship between genes is not so accurate. So you have to increase, but also you have to be careful about using accurate information. So there is a balance between size and accuracy.
That's very right. Yes, I agree. Good. Are there further questions? Not on Slido, not in the network. Then I take the opportunity to thank both of you for a wonderful presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Emmanuel and Florence,